And you know, I stepping with Marcus J live from the Den, Legacy Internet Radio. Thank y'all, everybody who's listening to us tonight. You're listening to us on TuneIn, listening to us during the replays on YouTube. We appreciate that. Thank you, everybody who has checked in to LegacyInternetRadio.com. We appreciate the love that we are getting at 804-402-2893. That is, in fact, the number to dial to be a part of the discussion tonight. We appreciate the crew of the listening party being here on the airwaves of Ain't No Half Steppin' with Marcus J, live from the Den of Legacy Internet Radio. We appreciate those brothers being here. They will be officially part of Legacy Internet Radio effective the first Thursday in February. You can hear those brothers talking about hip hop, old school, talking about samples. They got DJs coming in. So we're very, very excited to be a part of the listening party and having them a part of Legacy Internet Radio. Tonight's show is dedicated to the memory of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And so we'll be kind of talking about stories tonight that are Dr. King influenced and some of the what the hell, maybe so, maybe not. But, you know, we're going to stick with the socially conscious stuff tonight. And then later on in the show, we are going to ask, what would Dr. King say? And so I'm looking forward to that, Grizz. We're going to ask what the hell. Right now, it's just you and I. We W-T-H. Expect, yeah, what the hell. We expect that we will be joined momentarily by additional members of the Ain't No Half Steppin' Marcus J crew. When they arrive, we'll bring them into the discussion. But for now, it's you and I, 804-402-2893. Now, we start off the show by saying that we're socially conscious talk that's entertaining with a dash of humor and the top sports stories
right
of the week.
It's a lot.
It's a mouthful. But, you know, we want to make sure that we get everybody involved. Tonight, the first story that I am going to do where we ask what the hell, I am definitely glad that I'm sitting across the table from you, of all people, on this one.
Yeah.
I don't know if you heard this story, but I know you are going to have an opinion. I'm getting this one from thegrio.com. It's about a high school basketball coach. He was suspended after his team won the game 161.
ABA score.
To two.
Good defense.
They said, the Southern California high school coach has been suspended after his team suspiciously. I don't believe they use the word suspiciously right in the story, but they won the game by a score of 161-2, making it one of the most lopsided wins in state history. Arroyo Valley high school coach Michael Anderson was suspended for two games after his team's merciless victory last week against Bloomington High. He told the San Bernardino Sun on Friday, quote, "The game just got away from me. I didn't play any of the starters in the second half. I didn't expect them to be that bad. I'm not trying to embarrass anybody. Usually winning is a good thing, but the aggression which his team slaughtered the opponents had some feeling that a lack of sportsmanship was on display here." Quote, "People shouldn't feel sorry for them," said the opposing team's coach, Dale Chung. "They should feel sorry for his team, which isn't learning the game the right way."
And he threw his team under the bus. the losing coach.
The losing coach threw the winning coach because he's saying that the winning players aren't playing the right way. And so, Grizz, we're going to ask what the hell about this one. You know, what would, you know, you do in a situation like this? You know, your team is winning. You're winning big. Do you have a problem with the fact that the coach left the starters in the first half but then put in the bench in the second half and eventually end up winning by 159 points?
Nah, I wouldn't have had a problem as the opposing coach. I would have, first thing I would have did was, I'm curious to know what the score was at halftime. If it was anything indicative of the final score, it would have been like 80-1. They went 1-for-2 on a 1-1.
Right.
So, you know, so that, as the opposing coach, all the blame should be going towards the opposing. The opposing coach should not even have a job, nor should he even be teaching in that school. Because, you know, most school coaches are either the history teacher, the PE. He shouldn't even be anywhere near those children because he showed them through coaching and leadership a lackluster way of putting forth your best effort. You can't tell me. And what was it? It looks like a girls' basketball score. Was it a girls' game?
It was a girls basketball.
It was a girls game. Yeah. And I have a niece who plays high school basketball in AAU, and there are tremendous differences in talent in girls basketball. So I've seen a lot of blowouts.
Right.
You know, but still, that's not the winning coach's fault.
Right.
That's the losing coach's fault. And I'll paraphrase Jimmy Johnson one time when he was playing for the university. He was coach of the University of Miami.
Right.
When they was running up scores on, like, you know, what's this, Little Sisters of the Poor U,
right,
or whatever. He said, look, my job is to coach my players, not to coach or help the other team with some pride or whatever. If you got some pride, you wouldn't let yourself get beat like that in Southern California.
Hakeem is listening to us. What's up, Hawk? Hakeem says, cut that cat a little slack. He didn't play his starters in the second half. What is he supposed to do? We was just getting a call. Caller, we saw you calling. We had a little technical difficulty with you. Caller, call us back. We'll get you in on the live line. We're getting a couple of other hits in social media. We got a hit from Terry. Terry said that it's not a justified suspension. Who is the getting that call back? Caller, hold tight. I'll get you in on live line. Let me get these comments in the social media. She's saying, who is at fault? The other team is not as good. Why didn't the refs call the game?
Right.
The other coach should be suspended for not conceding the game.
Exactly.
He allowed his team to get mud stomped. And if the team would have won another game the same fashion without the coach, they should receive kudos. Call, I know you're there. Hold tight. Keith says he wouldn't be pissed. He let the other team. He would be pissed because he let the other team actually score two points. Shonda says she agrees with the unsportsmanlike. She agrees with the suspension. It's unsportsmanlike. They should have shown some mercy. And Kathy says she played sports. It's competition. Like competition, no one is saying they have to show mercy. If you ain't got the proper skills and tools to succeed, instead turn a blind eye and tell them to win some and lose some. Ain't no half stepping with Marcus J live from the Den. Legacy in that radio. We got a caller on the live line. Caller, what's your name? Where you calling from?
Peace, y'all. This is K-Dub, man. Calling from ATL. What's going on, family?
What's good?
What's K-Dub? Up, K-Dub? You got Jay Grizzy and Marcus J in the live line, man. You listening to us. What you want to get in on, our brother?
What's going on, family? Hey, happy MLK to the fam. You know, Marcus J, you know, I definitely got something to say about this because I'm from experience as well as what I'm doing right now. I'm going to say it like this on both sides. From the losing coach's perspective, hey, you just got to take that one on the chin. But I would be more so wanting to say this from the winning coach's perspective. First of all, you already know probably before the game or within the first quarter the level of talent that you're going to be playing against. So after, let's say, the first quarter, you need to go ahead and sit your starters. Secondly, what you will also want to do is, at some particular point when you're up, let's say, I don't know, 50, 60 maybe, hold the ball. Because as a coach, what you don't want to do is run up the score, because there's something out there called karma, and it hurts real bad. You could win a game by, what they won, by 150-something points?
159.
Okay, 159. Now, I'm not wishing this upon anyone that coaches, but you know what could happen at that particular point? Let's say the next game or maybe the game after that, something could happen to your star player. Something could happen to your entire, to your team that may not, you know, allow you to win a game or something crazy. I'm going to tell you, in the coaching field, stuff like that comes back to bite you in the ass. So, you know, from the winning coach's perspective, that's BS, dog. That's BS. You can hold the ball, and granted, you're going to win by a large margin, but 159 points? Come on, man. That's ridiculous. That is utterly ridiculous. He should. Now, in regards to the suspension, I don't know. I guess the state of California has to, you know, speak to that or what have you. But, you know, the winning coach, hey, man, once you up 100, what's up? You know what I'm saying? I understand that your bench players want to get in and score, but at some particular point, you need to stall the ball and just walk out of there with a victory, shake the other coach's hand, and keep it moving. But I'm willing to say that karma is going to definitely come back and bite that coach in the ass.
Now, one thing that you didn't really give me a straight answer on. So I am going to put you on the spot. You kind of glossed over it. The suspension. I mean, do you think the suspension is justified or not? Do you think that you are you are you? Because I mean,
I can give you reasons. I can give you reasons why I think it could be justified due to the fact, like, you know, the coach is able to control the end score. And he could have, like I said, the state could look at it like, listen, you could have stalled the ball. But also, do you suspend the coach because of the fact that your team is just so much more superior than the other team? If that's the case, you already know my experience playing basketball. Hey, I've won games by 60 points. I've won games by close to 70 points, you know. Granted, we didn't beat them 161-2, but, right, you know, there were substantial games where the game was pretty much over by halftime.
Well, let me throw something at you. Your friend in mind, Hakeem, is listening to us right now. You got anything you want to say to him?
Well, Big Hawk, what's up, baby? Hey, 502, Ramapo College.
Yeah. Hakeem is my man. He's asking what's the name of the school. Because he's got a family member that plays for Polytech out there in Cali, and they're ranked fourth in the nation. He's wondering if they play. Hakeem, the school in question is Arroyo Valley High Girls School. It's a girls basketball team for Arroyo Valley High School. And Hakeem, since you're listening, I want to know if you think that they should be there should be a suspension for this coach out here who you know, obviously ran at the school on these folks. And Kata, we know you are in fact a former basketball player in college as well as a current high school basketball coach. So it's very, very possible that at some point you could be on one or the other side of this, hopefully on the winning side. But yeah, you could, yeah, you know, this could, yeah, be something that you deal with at some point. And, you know, I think your position on it with regards to it being a karma type of deal is well received. Ain't no half stepping with Marcus J. Kato, how much time you got? You got time to hang for a minute?
I got. Give me 2 minutes. We got two minutes.
All right. So I'm gonna give you the next. I'm gonna let you kind of get a comment in on the next one, and then Jay Grizzy and I are going to move on with some other stuff. Ain't no half stepping with Marcus J. Live from the Den. Legacy Internet Radio, if you want to be a part of the discussion with us tonight, give us a call at 804-402-2893. That is how you are a part of Legacy Internet Radio. And we thank everybody that's listening to us, that is listening to us on their smartphones, that's listening to us on TuneIn, that is also listening to the replays on YouTube. This next one, I don't even really know how to set this one up. I mean, it's an odd one. It's about a young man who was being arrested. And he was being arrested for a parole violation of some sort of violation. And the police officer that was arresting him had a medical emergency.
Court of fame.
This one I'm getting from the rawstory.com. It's a Florida teen. Mm-hmm. Fort Lauderdale is where this happened. He was honored. He helped save the life. And this video that was released by the Fort Lauderdale Police Department, it shows that Officer Franklin Falks processing Jamal Rutledge after he was arrested for criminal mischief and burglary probation violations. Deb, I want your opinion on this. When Falks suddenly collapsed, Rutledge, quote, immediately began to kick the security fence and yell to alert officers in the area. Sergeant Todd Bunnan responded by contacting dispatch. Officer Robert Norvis and Raymond Ketchman quickly arrived to assist Bunnan, and the officers administered CPR and an automated external defibrillator device to attempt to restore his heart rhythm. Quote, Broward Health medical staff noted that Rutledge's actions and the quick response of these officers were largely responsible for Officer Falk surviving the medical episode, end quote. K-Dub, this dude was getting arrested and realized that the arresting officer was finna die.
Yeah, I saw the video of that. The description is a little bit different from the video. I'm not sure if any one of you actually saw the video. The officer was at the desk typing up whatever he would have been typing up. The young brother was sitting off to the officer's left, sitting in the chair, young brother got up. He kind of took a couple of steps over, saw something was going on. And granted, the video doesn't have any audio, but it seems as though he turns another way. He does kick the door maybe once or twice. But they didn't immediately rush to go help his brother. I mean, help the officer. They, you know, those officers that came, they walked up to the, you know, up to the door, not knowing that the other officer was, you know, on the ground, on the, you know, suffering from whatever he may have suffered from. My thing is that, hey, you know what? For whatever that young brother was detained for, you know, it could have went one of two ways, man. He could have not did anything and let that officer die. Lord knows what would have happened to him. Or he did the right thing, man. He did the right thing, informed somebody that, you know, the officer was in trouble. And when they came, they, you know, did what they had to do. I would say hats off to him, because above anything, you know, above anything as far as human to human, I mean, that is a human being that's in distress, you know. And I'll take my hat off to him.
I can dig
that's
it.
That's my comment.
Ain't no half stepping with Marcus J. That's our brother, longtime contributor to Legacy Internet Radio, as well as Ain't No Half Stepping with Marcus J. That's your man, K-Dub. K-Dub, any final words you want to say to the listeners before we let you get on out of here?
Hey, man. Peace to everybody that can hear my voice, that know my name or know of me. Everybody be safe. And, you know, hey, try to make the next day a better day than the previous day.
We can dig it, man. Appreciate it, man. Thanks for calling and checking in. We're going to talk to you soon, brother.
All right, brother. Peace. Right.
Peace.
Ain't no half stepping with Marcus J. It's your man, K-Dub. J. Grizzy, you didn't get an opportunity to get in on this story. Before I give you an opportunity, taking us back a little bit to the previous story, Hakeem's still listening to us. First of all, he's saying shout out to K-Dub, 502 baby all day. He's giving you a little bit of a hard time, Grizzy. He said he want that man fired from his job, his day job. He also continues, he's not sure if the guy should be suspended. He needs to find out about the other team. Maybe they're just getting started with girls basketball. Maybe they have some experience that they need. If winning coach is punished, perhaps the losing coach should be reprimanded as well. He knew the level of talent of his team as well as the opponent. So,
can I speak?
Absolutely.
Yeah,
before
let me
we move
speak on that.
Yeah, please do.
Firing the coach is not going to fix the apparently the squad is a beast of a squad if they putting up 162 and only allowing 2 points. So firing the coach ain't going to stop them from putting up another, you know, 100 and shutting down the other team the next game. So that, to me, I don't think firing the coach is anything. It's all on the loser. It's all on the loser.
No, I would tend to agree with you, Grizz. I don't think that we get anything out of suspending the winning coach. I think that's very unfair, because the whole purpose is to win the game. I think that there needs to be a discussion that does not solely place the blame at the feet of the winning coach. It is the coaches, there's the losing coach, there's the school
referees.
Administrators, there's the referees. I mean, there's all of these entities that are involved here that could have stepped up and said, hey, this is too much. Let's stop this. You know what I mean? You know, like Nomash, yeah. I mean, and to attack the coach and say that he's not teaching his boys or girls or team sportsmanship, I just think that's kind of baloney to me. And, you know, not the word I wanted to use, by the way. You know, you out there to win. And you're not out there to hurt nobody, embarrass nobody. But if the referees ain't stopped the game, then you're
supposed to do your job.
Do your job. Go out and win. What are you supposed to do?
Let the other team score another 150 to make it close.
You're supposed to not try.
Yeah.
You're gonna just be mad at them about sportsmanship, but then you're gonna teach your children, your team, to not try.
Right. It's like they got a bookie that's looking at the point spread. I don't think nobody was putting down that they would cover 159 points. You know, nobody is interested in that in a high school girls basketball game. Again, the opposing coach, the losing coach, should have been reprimanded. In what way he was reprimanded, I don't know, but he should have been reprimanded, because if I was a parent of the girl who was on the losing team, I would go to the coach and say, what the hell are you teaching them during practice? What is it? Is it a talent issue, or is it a you issue? You know?
I mean, you know, when you watch these games, I mean, there is oftentimes a, you know, a disparity between talent levels.
Mm-hmm.
But I just have a hard time placing
the blame on the
winning coach.
Yeah.
You know, there's, you know, I remember I used to play, you know, Little League baseball coming up, and we had, I guess we used to call it the mercy rule. You was down 10, it stopped the game. You know, I don't know if there's something here, but you certainly can throw in a towel. Hey, look, if Rocky can throw in a towel for Apollo,
throw the damn towel.
Yeah, we could do something here. Ain't no ass stepping with Marcus J. Live from the Dan Legacy Internet Radio. We'll be down with us tonight. Call us 804-402-2893. Thank you to the folks listening to us live on TuneIn. Our big surprise tonight, the listening party, joining Legacy Internet Radio the first Thursday in February. Looking forward to that. Hip hop, old school. They'll be joining the Legacy Internet Radio following All Throttle Radio on Thursday nights from 9:30 to 11:30. Grizz, when we stopped, we were talking about the young fella who saved the police officer who just arrested him for probation violation. What's your thoughts on that story as we set it up?
I like to concur with what K-Dub said. I mean, if somebody dying in front of you, whether it's a cop or whether it's the Pope or whether it's, you know, whoever, you want to get help for them, even if they are, you know, about to put you in the can. So, you know, he did what came natural. You know, I would think that would weigh heavily on his probation hearing. You know, if you actually saved the law enforcement officer's life, that's a big, big thing you can take into that probation hearing and say, hey, come on now. Y'all don't need to be putting me on papers no more. Let me go.
Does this neutralize whatever it is y'all bringing me in here for?
What you bringing me in here for? I mean, I know I did something wrong, but come on, I saved his life. I could have let him sit there and die.
I'll be honest with you, the way I'm built, I'm just not built for, you know, being that vindictive. You know what I mean? Right. Like, I would have to make sure that I did something to assist with the saving of the life of another human being.
And then I think I saw the picture where he took a picture with the cop with the other cops, right?
the whole bunch of police officers.
See, police is people too, ladies and gentlemen. Well, what we're saying.
I mean, I'm one of those people, man. You know, police are trained not to trust you.
Yeah,
they are trained. To not trust,
especially
you.
Black folk or people of color.
Absolutely, that's what Stop and Frisk is all about. Right. So they're trained to not trust you, and so part of me is, you know, not trusting them. Since right. They're not trained to not trust me. But at the end of the day, they're human beings. They got families. You know what I mean? Just like you and I do.
Yep.
And they want to go home every night just like you and I do. And yep. I got to respect that. Yep. I also know, just like any black person or any person of color or any person who is in distress, who does not have a voice, no matter what they say about Al Sharpton, they're going to call him if it's going down.
Oh, yeah.
Just like if the police are someone that you don't feel fond of, but if something go down in your crib, you calling
the police.
You know, it is what it is. Ain't no ask Stephen Marks J. Keeping it moving. We asking what the hell.
Mm-hmm.
And normally, what the hell, we asking what the hell on some crazy ass topics. Jay Grizzy, Marcus J are in studio here on Ain't No Ask Stephen Marks J. We're going to keep it moving, kind of soften it up with regards to.
Is it going
to
make me cry?
There's a couple that may in fact make you cry. I got one that's a feel good. I got two that's religious based, and then one that's going to be fist in the
air. I'm about to John Boehner this shit.
Yeah, so there's four more. One is feel good. Two is religious based, and the last one, fist in the air. All
right, you bring it around. You bring it back.
Bring it around. All right, and after we do that, we're going to ask, what would Dr. King say? And I'm very, very excited about that because tonight's show is dedicated to the memory of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. So you definitely want to stay with us and hear what would Dr. King say. But this next one, Grizz, it's about a high school. It's about a high school custodian. Mm. I'm getting this one from CBSNews.com by way of Mr. LP Steven Sykes. Being a custodian down at Trinity High School in Euless, Texas, was not exactly the most important job in our country, is it? It's custodian.
It's you a know, janitor.
And many people don't give a lot of stock to the domestics. I think that those people, I'll be honest with you, I'm most comfortable around those people. Mm. That's just me.
All right.
This is what this brother says. If I clean the toilet and you sit on that toilet, you can rest assured that is the cleanest toilet you will ever sit on. End quote. Charles Clark. This is what he said. He takes that job seriously. But his greatest asset has nothing to do with cleaning. It's all about counseling. Not long after he started at Trinity 25 years ago, Charles Clark began pulling kids aside. Kids he thought might be falling through the cracks. Kids he thought might be needing a little mentoring. Kids like 17-year-old Jesse Walaha. Quote, "Mr. Clark's been looking out for me ever since I've been here." This is what Walaha told the news station. "I can tell Mr. Clark anything. I know he's going to give me his honest opinion. He's very wise, very loving." "They've never known a man to tell them they love them before," said Mr. Clark. "Once they trust you and they know you love them, you can get them to buy into whatever it is that you're selling." And Clark says that most of his clients come from the school's counselors. Peggy McIntyre is the clinical counselor at Trinity with the master's in social work. But she says that Charles has a better way with certain kids. Quote, "He's worked with a lot of our students who ended up going to college, ended up doing very well. He gets results. He sure does. By all accounts, this custodian has helped dozens of kids turn their lives around, not because it was his job, but because it needed to be done. There's a lesson in there for anyone who feels trapped by their title." "You're going to tell me I don't have a good life? This custodial thing is working pretty damn good for me. Pretty damn good for me is my words," said Mr. Clark. I paraphrased what he said. That's the end of the story. Mr. Clark, he's a custodian, Grizz.
Hats off to him. They do, don't change the title, but it increases pay, I'm sure. He and Euless is outside of, I want to say it's North Texas. So, I mean, that's a lesson in regards to what does experience, life experience, or how you connect to another human being, how much value do you have to that? You know, not to be against the counselor or the person who has a master's in social work. I mean, I'm sure that she was trained properly and she has the right education to reach out to these children. But I was curious to know that someone who went to college or went to multiple years of education to get to that level to be able to reach children or help children, but it probably took a quote-unquote lowly custodian to be able to have an effect,
right?
You know, have an effect on somebody and actually having the educational level to help someone, you know, is two different things. And this is a perfect example of that. I know a lot of people, that's the difference between book sense and common sense. Someone who sits in a stuffy office all day with their nose up in the air thinking that they are going to do stuff for people, and somebody who's actually on the ground level, you know, right, and actually seeing these kids every day and then developing a trust level. And like we were speaking about the police situation where police are trained not to trust. And, I mean, sometimes kids are, depending on the school district they're in, they don't feel comfortable talking to a stinky teacher.
Right.
You know, because the teacher is the teacher. They're giving me homework. They're giving me, they doing this and that and the other. But the custodian, trust me, I went to public school. The custodian knew everything. Everything that went on. So, of course, I definitely could see why, you know, some folks were turning to, what was his name?
Charles Clark.
Mr. Clark.
You know, it's funny, man, because I agree 100%. I mean, I mentioned to you earlier, man, I've always been more comfortable with those types of people.
He had the skinny.
And, you know the guy who, you know, if anybody from St. Anthony High School in Jersey City, New Jersey is listening to us right now, y'all remember Bogdan.
Bogdan. What was his name?
Bogdan.
Yeah, that's he from Bogdan, the south.
No. Bogdan was somewhere from Eastern Europe.
Bogdan. A Serbian dude. So,
yeah, he barely spoke English, you know, but he was the janitor. He took care of the school. He took care of the building. And he was somebody who, you know, we didn't give him our problems or nothing, but we always had a kind word for him. He always had a kind word for us, and he barely spoke any English, but he was like, he was the dude. He was Bogdan, right? You know what I mean? And when I see a story like this, you know, there's a photo here of Mr. Clark.
Let me look at Mr. Clark. Let me guess, Mr. Clark is of color.
Yeah, he's a black dude. He's a brother.
Because he can empathize.
You know, he's a brother. And, you know, he's probably one of those people who, if by choice he chose to not be a custodian and decided that he wanted to go and do something else, I'm sure he could have.
Sure.
But this is what his calling was.
But he could have been easily, if the op, and just play, not even devil's advocate, but just put an opposing point of view on it. as far as opportunity is concerned on Martin Luther King Day, right. Speak about opportunity.
Right.
Mr. Clark, given the opportunity, could have been the counselor sitting in the stuffy office right. with the masters in social work.
Right.
As opposed to being on the ground level. Like, you know, I speak about this, and just to testify on my point, from my point of view, I work in a bank, and I see people who drop their titles all the time. People who drop their titles is like, well, I'm so-and-so and so-and-so, right? And I'm saying to myself, like, yo, you dropping that title, Mark, is looking at the final score. It's the final score, Mark.
The Knicks actually won tonight.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Wow. We're going to take that. We're going to take that. But I don't like it. I won't say I don't like it. I don't understand how people drop titles or put on airs because they think that title carries some weight to somebody. It might carry some weight around your circle of who you with, you know. But if you go to, you know, any regular everyday person, especially that's going through a struggle or whatever, that title don't mean
nothing. What I found is kids don't care.
Right.
Kids don't care. All they want is somebody to love them. All they want is somebody to act like they give a damn about them.
Fundamentals.
And listen to them. And the higher up you are in the social realm to a kid, I mean, as long as you're not like a celeb or something, but right. like a personal person, the higher up you are, the less credibility you got.
That's a good point.
You know what I mean? They can go and tell Bogdan or Mr. Clark, you know, what's going on, or have a conversation with him. When I saw that, when Mr. LP brought that story to me, I was definitely very, very excited about that. Ain't No Half Stepping with Marcus J, live from the Den, Legacy Internet Radio. At this time, I want to go ahead and introduce.
We got D'Angelo in the house.
We want to go ahead and introduce joining us here on Ain't No Half Stepping with Marcus J. It's been a while. Since we had our sister here,
they breaking this new album.
She's here with her co-host of the Green Room Version 2.0 with Jay Grizzy and Lissa P. We had these two here. They've been on hiatus on Wednesdays. We're playing replays, but they are here together for the first time in 2015.
That's the first time it came.
I got Lissa P. They have a conversation. They have a conversation amongst themselves. Comedian Lissa P. is in building.
No. Have stepping.
What's up, y'all?
Marcus J and crew. What's going on, fellas?
We doing.
Hey, light skinned it in.
I recognize how light skinned
that.
That's you.
Yeah.
That was you.
Yeah.
Salt
yeah.
and pepper. Yeah. Ebony and Avery.
Is that what we are?
Ebony. Yeah.
Word.
It's good to see both of you.
What's up, Liz P?
Hey guys, happy MLK Day.
We doing all right today. You doing all right today?
Good? Yes, I'm doing super fantab.
So you ready to kick it with us and do some what the hell, and you ready to ask what would Dr. King say and all that kind of
yeah,
stuff?
Yeah, I want to go ahead and touch on a few things before we go into that.
Sure.
Because I was listening to you on TuneIn.
I have a TuneIn
app going on my phone. And first of all, welcome to the new crew, the new addition to Legacy Internet Radio. Heard those guys.
The listening party.
Yeah, I was going to say I was listening to the party, but that is, I was listening to the party. Right. Heard they're going to have a little hip-hop knowledge going on, so I look forward to that. Super excited. And then moving on past that, getting into your topics. The guy who was arrested and the cop had the issue. Now, I heard what you guys said.
Cop caught a charla horse.
Is that what happened to him, really?
I don't know.
Oh, okay. I would have said, do you want to live? Right. Now, if I help you, all this is going to disappear, right?
You would have gave him a come to Jesus moment.
No, I would have been like, because the gotcha paper is a bitch and everybody is going to see it.
Right.
Can we say bitch on the show?
I just said it twice.
Right. Yeah, thank you. Right. Sorry. But yeah, really, I would ask, how important do you want to live?
True.
What can I get out of this deal? I can give you a few breaths and let you think about it. Or I can go get help. I let you say that.
You said the same thing like I said. I don't know if you were coming there, but I said if I was the person being arrested or breaking the probation, I would have used that to my like. Look, I need you to live. So
y'all
you can
basically
come in.
Taking a few minutes out of the few that he may have left.
Oh, yes,
to barter on
to
your
barter,
freedom.
How
yeah.
much? Okay. Yeah. How much does your life mean to you?
Because I'm looking at whatever. If I brought the, I've apparently broken probation, so I'm looking at whatever years I got over my head to go do. Now I gotta get out of jail free card because you spazzing on the sidewalk.
And what is me giving you some breath? You can just rip up that paperwork, brother. We can make this voila disappear.
Magic.
So, yeah, I just wanted to touch on.
I mean, there's people that would think that. I mean, we're not saying that we advocate leaving a cop dead on the street.
Oh no, definitely no. Please, I'm just saying, you know, some type of humanity.
Don't put that out there.
Please don't let anybody, you know, go choking to death and you not, you know, help them. No,
but if you're in trouble,
I'm just saying,
if you're in trouble, you know, the best person to have on your side is a law enforcement person who's in more trouble than you.
And if you don't like to have your photos put out there for the public to see in a negative type of way,
right?
With charges under it.
You know, you heard the Joe Morrison
you
story?
You won't do it.
You know about this guy?
Yeah.
I saw you spoke about him last week.
I spoke about it on social media last
week.
Yeah.
Even better, Joe Morrison. Like, if you're in trouble, you need to have somebody else on your side that's more in trouble than you.
And I didn't know that she was one of us.
Mm-hmm. Well, just to kind of set it up for our national listeners, Joe Morrissey is a local Richmond, Virginia politician who was convicted of the misdemeanor of taking indecent liberties with a minor. Translation, he had sex with a 17-year-old girl. He pleaded no contest. He was convicted, but he was a delegate here in Richmond, Virginia.
He voted
delegate in Richmond, Virginia. He resigned his position, and they ended up having a really quick election to fill his seat, in which he ran for after having resigned. And after having been convicted, he won the special election. But because he is on work release, he had to go to jail, and he found out that he won from jail.
Unfreaking believable.
He found out he won from jail.
And how do you walk to your cell? How do you walk back to your cell?
With swag.
With your chest out? Is that how you walk back?
Because he knows.
With an extra limp.
I'm going to tell you why, and I listened to Mark's show last week. I didn't call in, but, you know, the reason he can do that is because he's got dirt on somebody, you know, to correlate the story. Like, he's in trouble, but he knows somebody else that got into more trouble.
Here's my problem with that, though. You know, it's the same problem I had with Marion Barry and others.
Rest in peace.
A lot of people, yes, of course, a lot of people don't pay attention. You know, you would much rather vote for somebody whose name you know versus somebody who is actually, you know, doing the right things.
Right.
You know, a lot of these people that voted for Joe Morrissey knew who Joe Morrissey was. It wasn't about Joe Morrissey being a great delegate. And I actually got into a very spirited debate with someone who just didn't take it serious. Just like, you know, they told me that I was taking it too serious. I'm like, yo, you got to take this. Right. This is politics. This is somebody who you vote for to represent you. And when we talk about name recognition, and I don't want to get too far off task because I do want to move on to other stuff, but I saw a poll this morning of the potential Republican nominees for president in 2016. Leading the pack with 50% was Mitt Romney. Right behind him was Jeb Bush, Mike Huckabee, Sarah Palin,
and love her.
And behind them was Chris Christie. Chris, now, here's my very, very brief commentary on that. Hey, look, Mitt Romney, you lost twice. Jeb Bush, you're another Bush. Third time's just, I'm not seeing that being a charm.
We don't want Clinton.
Mike Huckabee is a far-right conservative who will have everybody going to church, to his kind of far-right evangelical church if he had his way. Mm-hmm. Sarah Palin can see Russia from her house.
Self-explanatory.
And then there's Chris Christie, who I actually like. But, you know,
he's a go-getter.
But nobody from my home state of New Jersey likes him. Keeping in mind that most of them are you know, moderates and
he would be okay if he didn't have the R beside his name.
But my point is, the first few names that I named are people who have already been on a national scale. When Chris Christie has not been on the national scale quite as much as the other. So why are we voting for people just because we heard of them? Do we ever pay attention to what they've done?
My question is, well, who's on the Democratic list? Do you have that one?
Well,
because unfortunately,
run a third term?
The poll says that we were just talking about the Republicans.
Right.
And so I'm sure there's a poll out there for the Democrats. I didn't see it.
Okay.
But I'm sure there is one. This was a CBS poll for the Republicans. It just kind of struck me as odd that we are looking at the same people. Like, where is the creativity with regards to people who may be able to do more than what you've already seen? And the people, like I said, Romney lost twice.
Right.
Jeb Bush is another Bush. Huckabee already ran and lost. And then there's Sarah Palin.
I heard that Huckabee, he was chilling, and he just decided he was just going to get up and run again. So I really don't know.
Exactly.
Even when he ran, I think before, I really never heard or understood his issues. Mitt Romney, he still has some explaining to do to me on a lot of his issues, especially behind women's rights. And I feel like out of all of them, seriously, the way that things go, Jeb Bush would be that one. He would be the 2016.
I tell you, listen, I agree.
That guy.
Here's where I agree with you. While I am not someone, I'm an independent who leans to the left, even though there's some, you know, right policies that I would tend to agree with. I did not like the Bush policies. I didn't like, you know, Daddy Bush 88 to 92 or Junior Bush from 2000 to 08. But what I will tell you is I always liked their swag, because when they decided they want to do something, they did it, and that was it. And I kind of dug that. I really did kind of dig that about them. I wonder if Jeb Bush would be the same way. From what I've seen with him, he's a little bit more less boisterous than his older brother and his dad. But I would like to hear.
You just don't know.
I would like to see what he's got going on.
My thing is really quick. I feel like the whole Jeb Bush and his tactics, I feel that, and because the beauty just walked in the room, I totally lost all train of thought. It was what I was going to say, but it has something to do on, I know. And maybe because I shouldn't have said it, or I should not say it, but I am, because I don't wish any ill will towards him. But let between now and election time, something happened to Senior Bush, I bet you Jeb will be at the top. And unfortunately, I feel that it would be pity votes, but I feel like it would happen.
That's very possible. He's been in a hospital a lot last year or so, yeah. And it's very possible that we may be seeing something going on with him. Ain't no half-stepping with Marcus J.